If you want to know what is really going on in the world, watch this video. There's a list of banned words that you cannot use in the media over the airwaves. But I'll tell you, there should be one more word de facto added to it because it's excluded. Find me one media person, just one, who will use the term Holy Spirit on the air. And I guarantee you, you won't find any. You'll find some that might use the term Jesus, some that might use the term God. But I have yet to hear anybody use the term Holy Spirit. This should be very, very telling. It's a total tell on the times. The times standing revealed. The whole purpose of these times is to exclude our attention from the Holy Spirit. Exclude the Holy Spirit from our attention. That is really the purpose of what's going on right now. Now, why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? Is the question. Now, in school, do you think there's any teacher anywhere that's going to use the term the Holy Spirit in school? No. Where do you hear this term? Where? Only place it would be in church, right? And even that, it's not used very often. But as far as our lives are concerned, this is a term, Holy Spirit, that is excluded to an extraordinary extent. And I tell you this, that the exclusion is purposeful. That is the purpose of the times that we live in, is exclude this term at all costs. At all costs, exclude this term. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is the reminder of the facts of reality to us. It is the reminder that God has given us. The Holy Spirit reminds us of the facts of reality. So gives us remembrance of these facts so we can realize that we cannot change facts. Why are we trying to exclude the Holy Spirit? Why are we trying to exclude remembrance of reality? Because we want to replace reality with our own reality of our own making. In other words, we want to be the new prime creator, replacing the old, replacing God, replacing reality with our own new reality based on facts that we decide what facts are. So we want to change facts. The first fact of reality is a reality cannot be changed, it cannot be replaced. That's the first fact. So we don't want to hear what the Holy Spirit has to say. And so we take all measures to try and turn our attention away from the Holy Spirit. Now, how do we do that? We offer up a substitute. Okay, there is a substitute born out of our desire to avoid the Holy Spirit. It's inevitable, right? We have this strong, strong desire to be prime creator, which means avoiding the facts of reality, which means avoiding the Holy Spirit. So to do this, we say, hey, wait a minute, there's something else over here that's just as good or even better. I like this even better. This is born of our desire, you see. So what is that? It's the goddess, okay? The goddess is born, as it were, or projected from our desire to avoid the Holy Spirit. It is the alternative that helps us to keep our attention off of the Holy Spirit. There is no real goddess at all. There is no co-redeemer. We say, well, the goddess is a co-redeemer. In other words, her facts and the facts of the Holy Spirit together, they redeem us. Even though the facts, one tells us the facts of reality, the other denies the facts of reality. And there's that mutual exclusive again, combining mutual exclusives, which is impossible. So first we say that. That's the beautiful face of the goddess. So you say, we say, oh yeah, both. Let's have both. That starts out that way. Let's have both. But then the more attention we give to the goddess, the more we find that the Holy Spirit is being excluded from our lives. Excluded from our lives, our family lives, our social lives, our career lives, our political lives, our lives within the country, within a world, the total gamut from our friendships. The total gamut is not used. I never hear that term used in casual conversation out in the world for my life. When have I ever heard somebody, when I'm interacting with them, use the term the Holy Spirit? Virtually never. And that should be the first word out of your mouth, you know. Blessings of the Holy Spirit to you today, you know, as you greet each other. all blessings of all clarifications of the Holy Spirit to you today. I wish you all clarifications of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit simply clarifies what facts are. It's not religious. The Holy Spirit's not. The idea we need to ban the Holy Spirit because the religious term is totally invalid. That comes from the goddess. The whole culture we have now is a goddess-based culture, which is designed to turn our attention away from the Holy Spirit. And more, those who are most zealous about their embracing of the goddess are getting all the key positions in society right now, all the key positions. I mean, has the president ever used the term the Holy Spirit? I don't know. But I certainly haven't heard it coming out of his mouth. You know, you get up there and address the nation and say, all blessings of clarity from the Holy Spirit to everyone in this nation. And I'd like to make some comments about that and go on, you know. Is that ever happened? I don't know, maybe I missed it. Maybe, I doubt it though. It doesn't happen. Do teachers get up in the morning and say, students, we're here to ascertain the facts of reality. And so all gratitude to the Holy Spirit in helping us, helping us in this endeavor, the true teacher. All gratitude to the true teacher. What is a teacher but someone who's supposed to teach facts, right? What is true? And what is the ultimate teacher of facts? The Holy Spirit. So all teachers should be giving praise and credit to the Holy Spirit. Same thing with the news. What is news? Shouldn't news be saying, hey folks, I got great news for you today. You know, I got really good news. Despite all the terrible stuff that's happening, and you can go on Google or Yahoo News or whatever, all these news sources, and just have this vast laundry list of horrible things that happen every day. And I said, you know what? In spite of all that stuff happening, the Holy Spirit is still with us, and it has not been affected by all this stuff, and therefore its capacity to clarify the facts for us is undiminished by all this stuff, completely undiminished. Who says that? Who goes on a news story? It should be the headline news story. Despite all the atrocities of the day, the Holy Spirit's capacity to clarify the truth for us remains undiminished. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Because the God created the Holy Spirit for us to remind us of the facts of reality, because we tried to deny the facts of reality and insist that we can change them, which is impossible. So we're on an impossible quest. And therefore, the only issue is delay. Delay, you know, how can we minimize the delay of the inevitable, which is realizing it's an impossible quest and setting down the quest. How long? And the Holy Spirit is here specifically to lessen the amount of delay. That's it, lessen the amount of delay. So it's really an atrocious culture at this time. I know the goddess is trumpeting. Constantly trumpeting one more. We're on the verge of global enlightenment, you know, all this stuff. Now, what she's really meaning is we're on the verge of excluding the Holy Spirit entirely and only paying attention to what the goddess has to teach us, which is that we can actually create our own reality. That's what she's trying to do. And that's really, again, there is no goddess. It's only a reflection of our desire that we be able to create our own reality. So we're not on the verge of some great global breakthrough. We're on the verge of some great global breakdown, actually. And for those who are aware of the Holy Spirit, it's completely obvious how the Holy Spirit is being pushed aside. Some say that ego means edging God out. Well, it's really edging the Holy Ghost out, really Holy Spirit out. Because the Holy Spirit is the activity of God in this world, which is only remembrance of reality. That's all that God does with existence, with our desire to be prime creator, is just remind us of the facts. Just say, hey, Spirit, you can't do it. You'll never be able to do it. You can't do it. Facts can't change. I can't change. Reality can't change. And you need to be reminded of the facts and have a continuity issue resolved for you. So this is what's going on in the world. This is the atrocity that's going on in the world. And it's done very cleverly, of course, but I've been pointing out the cleverness of it and showing that it can be seen through. But the collective will of the planet, it seems to be almost extinct, actually. The idea of using the term the Holy Spirit seems like the most terrible social gaffe possible, right? When, like, when you're in mixed company, who speaks up and says, "Yeah, the Holy Spirit told me, you know, clarified for me today, you know, this." Everyone like, look, oh my God, there's a nutcase. There's a religious nutcase in the crowd. This is really embarrassing. This isn't right. The goddess doesn't like this. She's trying to level the playing field. She's trying to do this. She's trying to do that. She doesn't like this, you know. This is making goddess feel uncomfortable. So initially the goddess starts out as, well, co-redeemer. We're on the same page. Holy Spirit and I, we're on the same page, she says. And then, you know, we're co-redeemers. I'm just trying to help in my way. Holy Spirit helps in its way. I help in my way. And the two together, bound to be very successful. Holy Spirit doesn't say that. A goddess says that. And then later on, the demanding side of a goddess comes out, and the princess comes out and says, "Now you must do this, you must do this, you must do this. No, that's wrong. This makes me feel uncomfortable. We need to change the laws. We need to do this." Super demanding side. It's like Janus. The goddess is Janus, two-faced. And she comes very, 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 very demanding. And then very, very aggressive. And it gets worse from there, actually. It's all downhill, actually. Once you edge the Holy Spirit out of your attention, it's all downhill. The goddess only pretends to be conciliatory towards the Holy Spirit. Like, yeah, we can get along. I can get along with anyone. I can find a way to get along with the Holy Spirit. But just first do this and this and this and this. And after a while, you find your attention is not on the Holy Spirit at all. And that's when you find out the true face of the goddess. And it's vicious, absolutely vicious. So once you get off track, then that's when the other side of the goddess emerges and you realize, oh my gosh, we're really in trouble. And then you get all confused and say, well, I don't understand what's going on. And you become addicted to listening to the voice of a goddess instead of the Holy Spirit. And you're in bad, bad, bad way, no question about it. I'm in a great way because I continue to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. That is, nothing obstructs the remembrance of reality. Nothing obstructs it whatsoever. I see that everybody, even right this instant, is completely unobstructed. Okay. But there's a desire that there be obstruction. Sensation is really a desire for blockage. It's a desire for that remembrance be blocked. Okay, we call our lives, what we call our life is really a desire that we feel a blockage of remembrance of facts. We feel a blockage is there, but it's not really there. It's like the bars of a cage. It doesn't stop the air from circulating in the cage, you see. So the blockage isn't there. There are symbols of blockage, yes. We've symbolized blockage. And we cling to this feeling of symbols, which we say is a feeling of blockage. And we call that life. And we think if we lose this feeling of blockage, we won't have any life. No, we won't have the symbol of blockage. It is the only thing we won't have. But actually, the Holy Spirit doesn't attack symbols at all. So we'll still have the symbols. It's just that we'll realize they are just symbols. Okay, the symbols are still there. The bars will still be there. But we'll just realize, oh, those are just symbols of blockage. They really don't block anything. And that's okay. So, see, the Holy Spirit gets us to see this wonderful, wonderful clarity on all of this stuff. The goddess absolutely does not. The goddess is busy setting up a new world order dictatorship. Okay? And let me ask you this, and ask the world this. In this new world order that is coming, is the Holy Spirit going to be relevant there, important, very relevant, and people feel completely at ease to use the term the Holy Spirit in all situations in their lives? Is that what we're headed for? Just ask that question of yourself. The Holy Spirit is a great clarifier. That has been my direct experience, no question about it. It's not religious in terms of saying you must worship this religious figure, worship that religious figure. No, nothing like that. It's only clarity of facts, just clarifying facts for you. That's all. I've always been comfortable with the Holy Spirit. It has acted in an immaculate way. Now, some often very mysterious way. It acted in a mysterious way yesterday, but I get it. It said, hey, I was getting off track, and it diverted me for some other silly thing, and so I ended up not going, you know, far down that road of delay, and so it was very helpful. But the Holy Spirit can act in ways that we don't quite seem mysterious to us, but they're helpful. They're very helpful. So, how much time do we spend in our lives discussing the Holy Spirit, thanking the Holy Spirit, listening to the Holy Spirit, acting on its direct direction that it gives us, following the direction, the path, going down the path that it points out to us? How much time do we spend on that? That's really the only variable that you can use to judge a culture and a world. That's it. Now, Jesus judged this world very harshly. He said that this world is under the influence of the Prince of Darkness. Okay. In other words, people are not turning to the Holy Spirit. I wonder what the judgment would be right now. I'd say my judgment is that the world is just absolutely cuckoo. You know, just so terribly off track. It's like virtually immeasurable. And we hear that people in droves are, you know, deserting the churches, etc. The churches really are a place where you go to be with other people who are also dedicated to listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit, the clarification of the Holy Spirit. That's all it is. It's saying, folks, you know, we're going to go and congregate and make sure that we feel comfortable and it's all right to talk about the Holy Spirit and say, you know, the Holy Spirit clarified this for me. It's helping me in my life clarify my, you know, purpose. What's the purpose? And that's what it is, really. That's why Jesus said, look, you can curse me. It's okay. You can even curse God. That's perfectly all right. No problem. Don't curse the Holy Spirit. So, really, the ideal church is not one based on either Jesus or God. It's based on the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit's the way that we remember facts. And who created facts? God created facts. But in our situation of worshiping symbols, we cannot just directly accept God from a pragmatic standpoint because we're too accustomed to symbols, believing in symbols, that symbols are our life. So we can't just drop all symbols, drop all perception. Perception is really symbolic. We'd have a continuity crisis. At least we believe we will. So the Holy Spirit enables us to keep symbols, not drop them. We don't drop them. We just see that they are symbols. How do we see that? By experiencing that they don't block remembrance of reality at all. They have no power to block. That's a symbol. It's like the constellations up in the sky. You know, people say, well, there's Leo, and there's Taurus, and there's Cancer, and there's Virgo, and there's Aries, and there's Capricorn, you know, all these various astrologers. Yeah, there's nothing up there in the sky. There's stars, but when I look in the sky, I don't see any constellations like that as far as, you know, these images that they claim. Those are all just projected symbols. They see the Pleiades, and they see, oh, there's the seven sisters up there. You see the eyes? No, it's like the man in the moon or the woman in the moon, you know, the person in the moon. There's no person in the moon. That's a projection of our symbols. It was never there. It was never there. But we don't have to stop saying, well, yeah, I see the man in the moon. No, we can just realize it's not blocking the remembrance of reality. So we don't have to throw away symbols, our life or anything. We don't have to change anything. We just recognize that all this is just symbolic and it doesn't block the remembrance of reality. It's really that simple. Now, when we talk about these times that we live in and how they're momentous times, and a little bit different than previous times. And what do we mean by that? What we mean is that through the use of pervasive presence of technology, high technology, it is now possible to coerce populations of the planet, the entire population of the planet, into turning away from the Holy Spirit and instead following the goddess's advice. So it's an unprecedented situation now where the momentum towards that now is greater than it's ever been, way greater. Therefore, it's becoming much more difficult to pay attention to the Holy Spirit. In fact, Jesus said, before he left, he said, there will come a time, the end of this age, where the prince of darkness will have so much influence upon this planet. And you might say the princess of darkness. It will be such a severe control and influence on this planet that even those who choose very strongly to listen to the Holy Spirit, the elect of God and lovers, they're choosing to listen, to be reminded of reality. Even they will be in danger of having their heads turned away from that towards the goddess and the misdirection of the goddess. That's how severe it will be. And we are definitely in those times. From having lived in this world since 1956 and seeing the progression of it all and being able to look back in the past to earlier in the century and studying history, etc., living right in the heart of it now, I can say for 100% sure that is a fact. We are in the end times. We're at the end of this age. There's no question about it. We're in the times where the pressure to drop the Holy Spirit is so intense that virtually everyone on this planet is in danger of doing so. So that is what the times that Jesus talked about, which means the other stuff that was talked about, Jesus talked about, is also going to take place, whatever that is. And you know, we're struggling what's exactly going to take place. But for me, the more importantly is to keep mentioning the Holy Spirit and its clarifications. Because without that, we're sunk for sure. We're sunk for sure. So whatever happens is going to happen. That, you know. So, but the clarity of the Holy Spirit tells us that everything that happens that we perceive as happening, everything is only symbolic. Everything that we perceive is only symbolic. And that symbols have no power to obstruct the remembrance of reality. That's what the Holy Spirit will tell us as fact. But since we have free will, we can choose to deny this fact and keep embracing this feeling of blockage. But that feeling itself is only a symbol. We're not really experiencing true feeling. Are experiencing it all. We're experiencing symbols of feeling, which is sensation. Sensation is symbolic. It's not real feeling, it's not real experience. We're not really experiencing it all. Symbols, you don't experience symbols. You imagine them. The point is, we get to keep all our symbols. It's just that we see that they are symbols, and we no longer try to experience them. All right, they're still there, like a shadow is there, but just now we say, oh, it's a shadow. You know, it's like we're trying, imagine if we're walking along, we see our shadow, and we take it that the shadow is us. That's what we are. And we keep trying to experience that shadow, you know. But there's no depth to the shadow, is there? It's just this, you know, sort of a dark outline on the ground. It's like that. And then the Holy Spirit shows us that, oh, that's just our shadow. That's just a shadow, just a symbol. We don't have to try and get experience through our shadow, through symbols. We don't have to try and feel symbols. We don't have to try and feel symbols. How do symbols feel? They don't feel at all. There's no feeling to them at all. You might say there's a feeling of blockage, but that too is a symbol. So it's really nothing. We're really experiencing nothing at all. Which is why inside we kind of feel empty. You know, we try to fill that emptiness up with sensations. We're searching, seeking for the ultimate sensation, the ultimate symbol. There's no such thing as the ultimate symbol. All symbols are equally meaningless. All symbols are equally meaningless. But we don't have to get rid of them. They do not block remembrance of reality. The remembrance that the Holy Spirit has for us is not blocked by symbols. And we simply need to experience that, that's all. So then, you know, the shadow's still there, but you just say, oh, I'm real, and the shadow is just a shadow, it's just a symbol, okay. So I keep walking, but now we realize the shadow is not what I am. Still there, still a symbol, fine, not a problem. But as you go around, you see people don't look you in the eye, they don't talk with you, and their heads are down, and they're looking at your shadow, and they're talking to your shadow. And you say, why are you talking to my shadow? And they say, huh? What was that? Who said that? There's a crazy shadow here. This shadow must be crazy. You know? And they're the ones talking to the shadow as if it was you. Now, who's crazy? You know? That's the question. Or who is, you know, off track? Who is eccentric? Who is eccentric? The one talking to the shadow must be quite eccentric, actually. So we have a world now that's based on whimsicality and eccentricity entirely. The goddess is completely whimsical. It's the worship of whimsicality and eccentricity. You could say badness or insanity too, but I try to be, the Holy Spirit has said, hey, you know, it's really whimsicality. You don't need to demonize it, you know, saying it's insanity or something. It's a more benevolent term, and I think it's an accurate term, whimsicality. So we have a world now that is turned towards that and saying, yes, we can. There's a way to be prime creator, which is whimsicality. And we have a guide to guide us there, you know, called the ego. But the ego has the face of a goddess, you know, the beautiful mother, the mother who can, like, we're like children trying to grow up into this realization of our own separate reality. And the mother is helping rear us, like we're a child, and the mother principle is taking care of all the problems, you know, and helping nurture us. It's the nurturing. We think we can be nurtured into doing the impossible. So we cling to mother figures, goddess figures, subconsciously, actually. But it's working out more and more in civilization, you see. You see it, absolutely see it. The attitude is completely obvious. You know, to me, it's completely obvious. We have people more and more put into key positions of authority over us who are channeling this mother nurturing thing about, yes, you can, we can accomplish the impossible. We don't need the Holy Spirit saying we can't. You know, that's terrible. So it really, this nurturing, this desire to nurture ourselves to accomplish the impossible is totally against the idea of no, we can't. It's an anathema to it, but it's trying to ease it out. It's trying to ease it out. We're trying to be weaned away from the Holy Spirit. And the mother weans us away from the Holy Spirit, saying, you don't need the Holy Spirit. I can nurture you. I can nurture you into accomplishing the impossible, making symbols real. Cannot. It's a complete waste of time. So the world is just embarking on another cycle of wasting time. That's all it's doing. All the while claiming it's just like we're in the verge of this incredible new age where, you know, everyone will listen to the goddess and therefore we certainly succeed, right? If there's nobody saying no, then yes must succeed. But you got to be careful. What are we saying yes to? Yes, we can change reality. Well, that can't succeed. It's a futile yes. And it doesn't matter how much nurturing we get. It doesn't matter at all. Complete waste of time. And, you know, the mother protects us from bullies. You look, the world thinks that the Holy Spirit's a bully now. That's how it's trying to position the Holy Spirit. Like, that's bullying. Yeah, you can't do that. And the mother is protecting us from this bully, the Holy Spirit, terrible bully, the Holy Spirit, saying, no, we can't. And that's hurting our feelings. They hear, no, we can't. We feel uncomfortable. It hurts our feeling. It's the princess and the pea syndrome, you know, that story where the princess, they put a... a pea, someone put a pea under her mattress. She says, oh, I feel uncomfortable. So they put another mattress. She says, oh, I still feel it. And they piled all these mattresses up until they had, like, mattresses went all the way up into the sky. And she's still saying, I can't sleep. This feels so uncomfortable. There's something there. The pea is like the Holy Spirit. And there's no amount of mattresses that you can pile up for the princess that will ever get her to say she doesn't feel uncomfortable, because the Holy Spirit's within us. It will never leave us. So the princess is always going to insist that she's uncomfortable and whine and cry and say, you guys have a war against women, or a war against the princess, a war against the goddess, trying, you know, that kind of stuff. No, we have a love of facts and a love of reality, as the goddess that has a hatred of facts and has a war against truth. That's the facts. It's the goddess that is warring against reality, which, again, it's our own desire to change reality is warring against reality. Goddess is just a symbol that we're using, the mother symbol, to try and wean us away from reality, from the Holy Spirit, remembrance of reality. So truth is an uncomfortable thing for lies. And in society, we have to accept that and refuse to be pulled down by this nonsense of over making people feel uncomfortable by using the term Holy Spirit. Well, I'll tell you what, those who refuse to use it are making me feel very uncomfortable, extremely uncomfortable, because I feel it's a war against remembrance, my remembrance and everybody's remembrance, and that should make us feel uncomfortable. That's really true discomfort. And we got this bogus definition of discomfort. All these definitions that are happening in the world are completely bogus. They're so upside down and backwards and bogus. And so we have an entire culture, a world society, based on these bogus definitions, inverted, upside down, backwards definitions. And that's called progress. So it is the worst of times. But if we see that, it can be the best of times for us. If we see it and we say, wow, I don't want to continue on with this dance of worshiping symbols and trying to make symbols real. You know, trying to, if we just, you know, embrace the symbols fervently enough, it becomes real. Is that true? Who made up that fact? Is that a fact? It's not any fact the Holy Spirit says. So you can't have a goddess-based culture and have the Holy Spirit too. It's impossible. You can't have them both. And of course the guy says, oh no, you can have them both. I'm not trying to exclude anything. I'm so tolerant. Nonsense. Completely intolerant to the Holy Spirit, because you can't have both. You can't have a culture founded on both. Because the Holy Spirit will tell you facts. Only tell you facts. It won't lie to you. And the facts completely contradict lies, which is what the goddess is telling, nothing but lies. So you can't have anything founded on foundation of both, because each one denies the other, the validity of the other. So if you try to have one founded on both, you'll have conflict for sure. And then the goddess says, yeah, well, we don't want conflict, so we better choose the goddess. I said, no, we better choose the Holy Spirit. Because again, the lies can't get rid of truth. And so when you have a culture founded on lies, you'll still be conflicted, because within, the truth is within you, and you'll still feel, you'll project it outwards. You can say, no, it's not within me. I'm pure. I mean, I've accepted the goddess entirely, so it can't be within me. It must be out there. And then you'll start attacking, projecting on others, and start attacking them. So really, it is not free of conflict in the slightest regard, basing a culture on lies. Inevitably leads to severe conflict. Only a culture that's based on truth, free, is actually going to bring peace. And again, it can't be based on both, because that would be incredibly severe conflict. It can't last even an instant, more than an instant. You instantly see this cannot stand. This foundation cannot stand at all. It's not a foundation at all. Again, the Holy Spirit only speaks truth, only speaks facts. And will instantly say, you know, facts to you, which you can't make symbols real. No, you can't. The first thing, the Holy Spirit, no, you can't. You cannot make facts. You cannot make symbols facts. lies facts. You cannot make symbols real. You can't do it. No, you can't do that. That's a fact. And the goddess will say, yes, you can. You can make it, because that's the whole purpose of a goddess, their desire to become prime creator. That's the entire purpose. So the goddess cannot agree with no, you can't. Cannot agree with it. And she'll do her dance and song and dance all around it, and, you know, throw a bunch of ornaments and bangles and dancing and singing, and hey, you know, look at me. But the Holy Spirit will say, no, you can't. You can't make symbols real, and symbols cannot block remembrance of facts, of reality. It's impossible. Yeah. So you can't have a culture founded on both of those. You cannot. What we've had up to this point is sort of a mixed culture in the world, where some aspects of culture do put their faith in the Holy Spirit and others put their faith in the goddess. And what's happening now is we want this one world, new world order, one unified globe, one foundation for everybody on the planet. That is absolutely what the designs and blueprint are for this planet. And therefore, you have to then choose, is it going to be the Holy Spirit or the goddess? There's no other way around it. If you're going to have a homogenized, one foundation world, supposedly to get rid of conflict in the world, if you're going to do that, you have to choose one or the other. And if you choose the goddess, you will have severe conflict. Severe conflict. Because you will project the truth that's within you. You'll feel that's traitorous to the goddess. And you're so scared of being traitorous to the goddess and obstructing the new world order, you will project that out and insist that you don't have truth within you. Someone else out there does, and they need to be attacked because they're trying to attack your peace of mind, that, you know, that kind of stuff. And so you'll have terrible conflict. You'll act in brutal ways, actually. Goddess cultures are extremely brutal. Extremely brutal. You're going to go toward the ways of the ancient Assyrians, you know, like that. You become like the, you know, Ninevans. That's goddess culture right there. Is no, we're not. We don't have any treachery within us. It's all out there. Our enemies are the treacherous ones. We must completely annihilate them. That's what happens. Where is the whole? If we choose a foundation of the Holy Spirit, oh, it's wonderful. People would just calmly sit and listen within and say, ah, no, I can't do the impossible. Wonderful. No, I cannot make symbols real. Wonderful. Hey, yes, I get to keep the symbols because they don't block remembrance. Wonderful. So there's no treachery within me at all. I don't need to project it out on anyone because I can accept the truth within me. Hey, you know, end of projection, end of attack, end of demonizing, end of all this stuff. So then you really do have a peaceful situation in the world. It's not an end in itself, because we'll be directly experiencing the remembrance of reality. We'll be in bliss, actually. So that's the choice. We have to choose one or the other, because with this new technology, it is going towards a new world order, one global governance, one foundation. That's where it's headed, and it's not going to be stopped. There's no way in the world that's going to be stopped at this point. So that is the battle that's going on in the world right now, is what foundation is there going to be? There's not going to be one foundation for this group, another foundation for another group, one foundation for this country, another foundation for another country. There's a global will to settle on one foundation for the entire planet. And the way that it's going is that it's going to be the goddess, that is for sure. Which is why I say relocation from this planet is necessary, actually, if you want to continue to focus on the Holy Spirit. Because you won't be able to have isolated groups on this planet anymore. And in the past, you had these pockets of areas that people could focus on the Holy Spirit. The idea of the United States, people came here, they felt there was so much land, they could get away from the oppressiveness of their governments trying to tell them, you know, what to focus on. And if someone oppressed them, they could just move further west or out in the boondocks and have a village, have a city, a culture out there. for instance, like the Mormons as an example, they moved out to Utah and they said, look, we're going to focus the way, you know, we want to focus out here, and nobody can tell us that we can't. Well, those days are gone. Those days are absolutely gone. So the planet is to say no more to that. We're going to decide on a unified foundation, just one principle foundation, not pockets here of one foundation, pockets there of another foundation. Everyone's going to be on the same page. There's that intense demand that this take place. And technology is wedded to that demand. So that is what is going to happen. Invariably, inevitably, the Holy Spirit has told me that absolutely that's what's going to happen. It's a fait accompli. So, with that in mind, you have to say, wow, wait a minute, do I want to live in a goddess culture? I sure don't. I'd rather live in a Holy Spirit culture, because those are the two alternatives. Of course, a goddess culture will still use terms like God, but they'll substitute, you know, goddess for it, or God, goddess. I remember the transition, for people would first say God, and then later on, as they were transitioning to a goddess culture, they'd say God, goddess. And then next, they just turn to just goddess. That's the perfect example of how it works. So we went through a phase where God, goddess, and people said, oh, no, look, we're including both. And now we're into the phase where the God is basically going to be dropped. As a matter of fact, the Air Force Academy just dropped it. It made it optional as the loyalty oath. Don't you have to use God anymore? I'm surprised they didn't say, well, you can substitute the term goddess for that. But it just shows you the sign of the times that we're in. And remember, the goddess is just a expression of our own desire to be prime creator. And a desire that we have a way to be nurtured into that. That's all it is. It's not a war on, to say these things is not a war on women at all. It's pointing out the facts of this dynamic that we try to put a mother principle in authority over us to try and nurture us into accomplishing the impossible. That's what's being said here. Women have just as much access to the Holy Spirit as men, no difference whatsoever. They can simply listen within, and the Holy Spirit will clarify everything for them just as much as they clarify for men. Absolutely. Now, the ways the Holy Spirit may clarify might be different. They're different in every single person. It's custom, very custom for everyone. But now, no difference whatsoever between men and women as far as the Holy Spirit is concerned, as far as clarifying for them. None. Absolutely none. And yet, we do have to point out that the so-called matriarchy that is being coming back into power and place is this mother nurturing principle of trying to nurture us to accomplish the impossible and trying to exclude the Holy Spirit. Absolutely is. But that does not have to do with male female so much as it has to do with the mother principle, so to speak, of nurturance of a child, so to speak, someone who's kind of helpless, right? Because when we're trying to accomplish the impossible, we feel helpless. So we say, who can help me? Ah, there's the mother, you know, we pattern it after the mother. Say, oh yeah, she's there to help me because I feel so helpless. But she can do all this stuff. But in our mind, we feel helpless to make lies true. But we have all these plausible schemes of how it's done. And those are seen as the great mother who has all this very clever schemes. And we think, wow. It seems possible. It seems plausible or possible. Maybe it's possible. That's what we think. We think maybe it might be possible. I just don't know how, but this mother really seems to be able to do this dance. Is like, yeah, it's possible, it's possible, it's possible. Or it's plausible, it's plausible. Remember, plausible is only the play of symbols. Plausibility is only the play of symbols. So you can play symbols and make it seem relatively possible relative to another symbol. So the ego, the dance of the ego, which is another term for the goddess, is just a dance of plausibility. It's a dance of symbols, that's all. And it's relative to other symbols. It's not relative to facts at all. And so when we say we're in a state of delusion, it's because we don't see this. Is we take the relative as having meaning, relativity of symbols as having some sort of factual relevance or meaning, when in fact it has no meaning at all. No real factual relevance, none. And of course there are those who hear this and say, yeah, that's the right, but then they say, well, but the goddess has a different way, and she can get me to the same place. In other words, what they mean is, she can have equal influence over me, you know, equal influence. I can be influenced both ways. That's again the idea that mutual exclusives can be combined at the same point, and they can't. They can't. What happens is you go one direction for a little while, and then you go back the other direction. You go one direction. You're not going two different directions at the same time. It's impossible. So you're vacillating. You see, vacillating. You go one way, one. But this is actually can be a recovery process as you go through this vacillation, you know, oscillating. If you can gradually see, wow, I am vacillating, I am oscillating between the goddess and the Holy Spirit. And first I listen to, influenced by one, then I'm influenced by the other, and then there's one and the other like that, and they say, wow, I'm tired of this, I'm really tired, can I not just settle on one or the other? And of course the ego says, oh no, you can settle on both, which again just keeps the oscillation going. Eventually, you see through that lie. That's like the biggest lie, really. You can do both. That's the biggest lie. Which is why what I'm sharing continuously harps on this. You cannot have mutual exclusives. You're going to be oscillating. That's very feeling of very bad instability. So to stop that, you have to be weaned away from this notion that you can have both, which is what the ego goddess is telling you, of course, to preserve their influence over you, of course, so at least you give them some time. They say, no, we're just helping you do both, and then they have influence, it has influence over you, and then you listen to it instead of listening to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will say, you can't have both. You either have one or the other. You can't have both at the same moment. Okay, you can't have both at the same moment. That's why we have time. Time is just the oscillating between these two influences. Whereas if you choose just one influence, there's no oscillation, is there? So that influence is true for you right now. The influence is there right now. And it's steady. So we don't have this psychological sense of time, of oscillation, of influence. Like, well, I see this way now, but the next moment I'm going to see it a different way. So I need that next moment being different from this moment. That's called psychological time. I need the next moment to be different from this moment as far as truth and facts go. I need the vision to be different. I need to see, if I see the tree this way right now, the next moment though I need to see it the other way. That's psychological time. That's what we talk about when we refer to time. That's time. And that's trouble. That's instability. So it's the 27th of October. It's always a auspicious day for me. I had a terrible night last night, though. But today is the auspicious day for me. It always has been. So maybe, you know, it goes in cycles. Maybe it'll repeat. The end of October and the 27th has been very auspicious in a lot of ways. But this clarification here is very auspicious, actually, because it's plain truth, plain sharing of the truth, sharing of facts here. And who can do that in this world? Who's actually doing that? It's very rare, actually, because people have been bullied by the goddess, by the matriarchy, severely, fairly bullied. The matriarchy is the bully, as a matter of fact. Because what do bullies do? They push you in a direction you don't want to go in. And really, none of us want to go in the direction of suffering, continued suffering and travail and delay and psychological time. And the matriarchy bullies us in that direction. It's a severe bully, but it's put on the last 50 years. It's tried to put on a smiley face, you know. but its fangs are now leaking through the face, you know. They really are. And Halloween, of course, is coming up where people love to express their inner viciousness, you know. and loyalty to the matriarchy goddess, ego, egoic complex. And I detest Halloween. Really detest it. I have a pumpkin and that's it. It really All Hallows Day. I think it's supposed to be a day that celebrates the saints. I wonder how much celebrating of saints take place in our culture, right, on that day. So today, it may be that today is the cultural, the whole thing is over, because I've been able to clearly elucidate it here. And maybe that's all that's necessary. Impact of clear elucidation, who can measure it, actually? Who can measure that? How is it? Holy Spirit can measure it. I can't measure it. But just the ability to say these things clearly is like a miracle, given the times. You know, given the times, it's very surprising. A miracle is kind of something like really beneficial you don't expect. Like, how in the world did that happen? I didn't expect it was going to be able to happen. It was like, wow. That's amazing. Saves us a lot of time. What is time? Oscillation, right? Oscillation between Holy Spirit and ego, Holy Spirit and Goddess, Holy Spirit. Oscillation. So a miracle saves us time. In other words, it saves us oscillation. It saves us from a lot of oscillation. We stop oscillating so much. We say, wait a minute. Maybe I'll spend more time with the Holy Spirit there. I really won't give much in time to the ego, Goddess, matriarchy, and less oscillation. Saves a tremendous amount of psychological time, oscillation. So that's what a miracle, according to Jesus, that's what a miracle is. So the Holy Spirit gives us miracles. It means it saves us a lot of delay, a lot of time, psychological time. It saves us from that, a lot of it. So we don't be oscillating our way for, you know, millions and millions of more years. Maybe the oscillations could even end today. But we're at the phase now where the ego, goddess, matriarchy feels it doesn't have to play fair or fair anymore, or put on a conciliatory face anymore. We're at that phase. So that we're at the phase of non-viciousness, where it won't say, well, maybe both. Yeah, maybe both. No, it's to say, no, my way or the highway is what it's going to say. So we'll hit the highway on our own, on the Holy Spirit's terms, actually. It's kind of like a child decided to go back to sleep. So you say, okay, you want to go back to sleep? All right. We'll wait until your dreams become so fitful again that you want to wake up. But it won't force you to awaken. You can't be forced to awaken. You can't be forced to remember reality. You cannot. No, your free will cannot be forced. It has to be voluntary. Has to be something we accept within us. So I look forward to the days to come. It hasn't been easy, and it's certainly not easy right now. But I certainly look forward to them with great eagerness and anticipation of what is the Holy Spirit going to do for us, is the question. That's my question. And the Holy Spirit has amazing ways of working that are, in retrospect, I find him quite humorous. He has a great sense of humor. It's so creative that it leaves you saying, like, wow. that's something to chuckle about, really. How it managed to outflank the ego, you know, in such a wonderful way that I could have never, you know, foreseen that. So it's hard to foresee what the Holy Spirit will do. Very difficult to foresee it. But it's going to come now, very, very soon. Maybe even today. So stay focused with a feeling of anticipation, glad anticipation, and positive anticipation. Say, hey, okay, I know something really very helpful is going to happen. In other words, freeing me from the oscillation of mutual exclusives, which we call psychological time. Freeing me from that. Absolutely, I'll be freed up from that. Have steady vision, which is bliss. Steady vision is bliss. Freedom from psychological time is bliss. Freedom from oscillation of trying to please both, be under the influence of two different mutual exclusives. Freedom from that is bliss. It's that simple. It's that simple. looking forward to the experience of bliss. All right, very great. Everybody, hang in there. We're all oscillating, okay? Nobody's being attacked here or pointing out you're bad. No, just factual. We need to lessen that oscillation between mutual exclusives. Let it settle down. Be solemn. If you need to be solemn, that's a phase two. When you realize, oh my gosh, I've just been, you know, none of this was necessary. That you can feel very solemn, like, wow. And that eventually, that will resolve. Resolve it and you go towards more bliss. But there is a phase where you say, holy cow, I've wasted a lot of time, haven't I? Yeah. And that feels very solemn. So that's fine. I'm going through the same thing, and no one's being attacked. Voluntarily, watching the videos voluntarily, just to point out the dynamic of what's going on, and you say, hey, you know what? I can see that this oscillation, I want to escape that, and I can escape it. And it's something we're all of us have been doing this. All of us, absolutely. Trying to be under two different mutual exclusive influences. And thinking that there is a way to remain under mutual exclusive influences. The fact is they're simply oscillating, which is this terrible instability, which is the absence of bliss. It's the absence of bliss. What we're experiencing is the absence of bliss. And really, we don't want to keep on experiencing the absence of bliss. That's a fact. All right. Very great. The weather is changing here in the Bay Area. And it's actually going towards a colder spell. The cold air is pouring in, and that's how it goes. And yet, we are feeling very much focused right now. All right, that's it.